jab, tuck across, you know, your kicks, and then also learn distance control. So like the things that we talked about with the left knee, with the right knee, not blindly throwing off the combination. So all these things that I teach is like, you know, hit, boom, come right back to your stance, be like, okay, what's available? One, two, I come in, come back to my stance, what's available? Because you're watching for their reactions. You know, I guess the other portion is to be really active all the time, active in your mind. So when you're doing a drill, and you're coming, you're providing the offense, don't just, if it's one, two, left kick, don't just go left kick. Really look at it and see all those variations from outside. Left kick, what happens to the pose counterattack, right? I mean, don't be a dick about it and make it hard for him to learn the technique, but play around with it. Be active, work your footwork at every moment you're in the gym. Shadow boxing, so shadow boxing is hard. I hate shadow boxing, but you know, you have to put a lot of mental energy into it. But with drilling and tie pads, being active, and being always ready. So like, I hit, when I finish my left kick, finish the combination, don't just be like, okay, now I'm good. Hit, hang, aim a lot still. And look, what next move can I do? And same with the partner, they should always look for that little thing so that when you go into technical sparring, you have these ingrained. One last little thing will be, when you're a pad holder, really be active. Actively understand what's going on. Because for me, my history, I started pad holding before I started really getting good at sparring, before I started fighting, and then I went back to coaching after I had to retire. Right? So, if I didn't pad hold for a lot of fighters, I don't think I would have been able to fight. Because I couldn't pick it up in sparring. It's too fast. When you're a pad holder, you're controlling everything, right? Because the pad holder is in charge. So when he throws, okay, I go one, two, bang, bang. I see, oh, what dips does he have? Oh, every time I throw one, two, their right hand drops a little bit low. And then I tell him, pick it up. It makes you register these little cheats that people do. And when you're sparring, you see it. Now you're actually counterattacking for real. Same thing when they throw a left, like a kick, for instance, boom. I mean, I want to see when they kick, boom, are they clean? Or can I hit them? So those things will develop the technique and timing. Put in small, like slower, controlled technical sparring, and then hard sparring. I'd say hard sparring is probably the least important of things to work on. Because actually, that's where you will restrict your techniques to what you feel safe with. Maybe do that like once or twice, but just to really test it out. Technical sparring should be there at the warm-up, at the end, as a cool-down, it should be there all the time. Same thing with clinch. Like, if anyone asks about clinch, like, it's hours. It's hours getting comfortable with the technique. No special techniques involved. But yes, you have to learn the fundamentals, but really it's getting the feel of the technique. So, I mean, in Thailand, you go an hour in the morning, an hour at night, every day, 6 days a week, and that's when they're tired. They do that for how many years consistently? They just rest, just like in jiu-jitsu. They're not gonna go hard and then rest. They play slow, they play soft, they use technique. Really watch how they train, and you can incorporate a lot into striking. It's like with ego strike, you wanna hit hard. With jiu-jitsu, don't say the technique is involved. That's pretty much it, I guess.
All right, let's give her a hand.